And a guten Chodesh, Chodesh Teves. My name is Richard Joel. I work for many of you. All of you think I work for you. I've been asked to announce that there are many empty seats, so those of you in the front, feel free to move back.
I've always wanted to say that.
So it's so wonderful and hopeful, right, at a night of Hanukkah, to have this number of quality people who come together to celebrate the work and to celebrate people who are committed to that. And it makes it all worthwhile. These are not, I'm always reminded that it's the winter solstice, and somebody today said to me, it's always darkest before the dawn. And I said, how long do we have to wait for the dawn? And the person walked away. But the beauty of Hanukkah and the beauty of Rosh Chodesh is that both of them stand for the concept of Hidchatshut, the renewal. That Hanukkah, we know that of the darkness of the tzoras that we all had, right? It was the light of the candle that pierced the darkness, and it was the light of the commitment of the Jews that pierced the spiritual darkness. We know on Rosh Chodesh that we're reminded monthly that life is in cycles, and that it gets brighter and it gets dimmer, but it gets brighter again. As I'm sure you do when I look at the magnificent fall colors of the trees, especially those of us in New York. In Los Angeles, you just watch them drop dead. But in New York, you have the beauty of the trees turning great color, and then you have the sadness of them falling to the ground. But those of us who know that as surely as Rosh Chodesh comes, and as surely as after the waning comes the spring, and comes the regrowth. And I think in so many ways, the story of our people is the story of Hidchatshut. Even in our tefillah, we say, Chadesh Yomeinu Kekedem, renew our days as of old. We never abandon the principles that made us eternal, but we always hope that we bring it with it the sense of renewal. And therefore, this is a wonderful evening together. We are very proud at Yeshiva University. My name is Richard Joel. I'm president of Yeshiva University this week. Very proud that Yeshiva has partnered with the Jewish Publication Society, an extraordinarily important enterprise, in hosting this auspicious event celebrating the release of Outside the Bible, Ancient Jewish Writings Related to Scripture. Now, I'm sure that over the next few days, all of you will have the opportunity to read every page. But we want to congratulate in absentia Professor James Kugel, Professor of Bible at Bar-Ilan, for his effort in this immense undertaking. And we especially celebrate the accomplishments of his co-editors, our very own Professor Dr. Louis Feldman, who in fact can talk to us all about Hanukkah in the original Greek. He serves with distinction as the Abraham Woke Family Chair in Classics and Literature at Yeshiva University, and Dr. Lawrence Schiffman, Vice Provost for Undergraduate Education and Professor of Judaic Studies at Yeshiva University, to the joy and benefit of all. I always also want to acknowledge the presence of Professor Alex Jassen, who is part of the collaborative team, and you'll be hearing from shortly. And somebody jokingly said that he took Larry Schiffman's place at NYU. And we know that nobody can take or wants to Larry Schiffman's place at NYU. We've retired his number. And once he got his training at NYU, it was wonderful that he came forward to us at Yeshiva. Additionally, a host of other Yeshiva luminaries and personalities contributed to the publication of this impressive work, among them Dr. Joseph Angel, Dr. Yaakov Ellman, and Dr. Richard Hittery. So many aspects of Yeshiva University contribute to its status among the great institutions of both Jewish and secular learning. But I have to say that one of the points of pride that I take is the incredible growth of the Bernard Revel Graduate School of Jewish Studies and the incredible gathering of scholars who join with Professor Feldman, who make him a little less lonely, in creating out of Yeshiva a place where the light of Jewish thought shines, and shines brightly and uninhibitedly. And I think it's very important. We have all committed so much of ourselves to have our students own their Jewish story and to persuade parents that the growth in Jewishness doesn't end at the end of high school. Students, if they need college-level political science, maybe need college-level Torah as well. If the recent Pew study, since I'm a speaker and I'm in the Jewish community, and it's within 6 months of the Pew report, I have to mention it. But if the recent Pew study tells us anything, it's that Jewish identity will not be enough in sustaining our people. That, frankly, if there's not education, if there's not community, and if there's not passion, there's nothing that will transmit. It can be like a candle that you try to light, but it doesn't sustain its flame, and it most assuredly doesn't kindle other candles. We have to advance earnest and meaningful Jewish literacy. So, of course, we encourage the young women of Yeshiva to take on the 3,301 pages of text in Outside the Bible, which demonstrates so much the beauty and importance which lies beyond the basics. A reading of these volumes with apocalyptic visions and prophecies, folk tales and legends, collections of sayings, laws and rules of conduct, commentaries, ancient prayers, all of these build a more colorful and textured understanding of our Jewish history and our Jewish story. Aside from the great value of Outside the Bible within the canon of academic knowledge, I also believe it serves a different purpose that has to be spoken of, ladies and gentlemen. And it's a critical issue. We and our children have to appreciate scholarship. We have to appreciate learning. We have to support the notion that ideas are what sustains and kindles civilization. That this civilization that we believe in has to be committed to something more than shopping. And that we have an opportunity to teach our children, that they have to base their lives on serious thinking, on serious reading, on serious learning. And that will bring great joy to the world. So may the light of this Hanukkah and of what we are about to experience be kindled and be joyous for us and for our children. It's my great pleasure to call upon our partner in this venture, Director Rabbi Barry Schwartz, who's the director of the Jewish Publication Society.
Good evening. Hanukkah Sameach.
It's Jason.
The Jewish Publication Society is deeply grateful and proud to join in this wonderful event, launching the publication of Outside the Bible, Ancient Jewish Writings Related to Scripture. What better way to conclude our 125th year than celebrating the publication of this landmark anthology? Our sincere thanks to Yeshiva University for hosting this gathering, to its president, Richard Joel, museum director, Jacob Wise, and their staffs. I think it is a remarkable tribute to this university that two of our three lead editors of this monumental 12-year, 70-scholar project, Lawrence Schiffman and Louis Feldman, serve on the faculty here, as do several other noted contributors. A special thank you to Alex Jason for participating in the program this evening in conversation with his teacher, Professor Schiffman, whose enthusiasm and support of this endeavor from its inception with my predecessor at JPS, Ellen Frankel, who is also here tonight, has been vital. I would like to acknowledge the presence as well of Carol Huffing, managing editor of JPS, who has lived and breathed OTB for the past decade. As Jim Kugel pointed out last week, OTB also stands for off-track betting. And there were times when we thought that bringing Outside the Bible to publication felt like an ill-advised wager. But here we are, and the production of the book, I should say books, could not have happened without the heroic effort of Donna Scher, director of the University of Nebraska Press, our publishing partner, also here this evening, in fact, who came all the way from Lincoln, Nebraska, and with thanks to her dedicated staff. The Sarah Siegel from JPS is that key behind the scenes person who is to be thanked for all her logistical support for this evening. And finally, our board members, represented by David Lehrman, the immediate past president of JPS and a major donor to this project. And to all our donors from the National Endowment for the Humanities, to those individuals listed in our book, they all deserve our heartfelt gratitude. One of the great books included in our anthology, of course, is the Books of Maccabees, which tells the story of the festival we are celebrating this evening. While excluded from the Hebrew canon, it was rescued from oblivion by the early Christian community, a remarkable historical backstory in and of itself. Now it is regaining its rightful place in a Jewish compilation, thanks to the extraordinary work of modern scholars like those here this evening. We are privileged to witness this academic renaissance. Thank you all for being here, and happy Hanukkah. It is my pleasure, I was going to say, to call to the bima, to call to the stage, Professor Schiffman and Professor Jassen. They will have a conversation now about outside the Bible, and anything they say wrong will be corrected by Professor Feldman immediately afterwards.
Well, I just want to say just one brief word of thanks to all the people who were thanked that I won't repeat over again, but without them, this thing never would have come off. And also thanks to President Joel for joining us this evening and for supporting our work. And we all look forward to the rest of the program and to Professor Feldman's closing remarks as well. And just with that, I guess we should get going.
Thanks. I also want to express my thanks to all the people who were involved, many of whom I know by many, many emails that I was sent, reminding me to give my contributions, reminding me. This is just a massive undertaking, and I think it's a wonderful testament to, as we've heard over and over again, the degree of interest in these classical Jewish texts. And I think also the degree of interest among the general public, witnessed by everybody who's here, this is really an anthology written for everybody, for scholars, for anybody who's interested, and I look forward to talking a bit more about this and what we have put together.
By the way, I noticed on the brochure that it says that there are slightly more than 70 scholars. So I guess it harks back to the first Hellenistic Jewish text, the Septuagint, and we may have produced a kind of a Septuaginta Nova or something like that, if my Latin is permitted by everyone here.
Well, very true, yeah. We were not working in isolation, thankfully. I want to start off by asking Professor Schiffman here to share with us what he thinks of what it means to talk about Second Temple Judaism. This is a term we've mentioned a few times already, and the anthology Outside the Bible is meant to illuminate the world of Second Temple Judaism. So perhaps, having written a textbook on the history of Second Temple Judaism, you can tell us what that term means.
We could speak in a way just chronologically and say that it's from about 540 BCE, the Persian period, running through the Hellenistic period and up through the destruction of the temple in 70 CE. We could speak that way, but I'd rather not. I'd rather call attention to the fact that this is a period in which massive changes were going on in the Jewish people and the Jewish community, moving from what we call in the scholarly world Israelite religion, that is to say, the biblical tradition of what one could sort of jokingly call our Bible as opposed to their Bible. And in that, we have a whole series of changes going on. But the most important thing about the Second Temple period is that when you understand that period, you understand much more about the rabbinic tradition and how it came into being and how it's a kind of sorting out after a very long process of debate and disagreement and of all kinds of differing competing approaches. And also, as we hope to talk about a little bit later, it's to some extent also a way of enabling us to better understand how Christianity developed.
So you want to give us an example of something that, from the transition of the world of the Bible to the world of second comes.
Well, okay, so let's just take a very small example that will sort of make this clear. So, according to the Bible, it appears that a man is allowed to have more than one wife. Now, even though one could read the book of Genesis as indicating that this sometimes can be rather problematical, some people will jokingly say it's a problem to have one wife or one husband, but in any case, leaving this aside, now when we enter in the Second Temple period, we find a vigorous debate about this. Now, in this vigorous debate, we have, first of all, sectarian Jews from the Dead Sea sect who insist that the king can only have one wife, and they also, that's in the Temple Scroll, which is one of the things that I contributed to this volume. Some people know that I've been like working with that scroll forever. But also, we have the so-called Damascus document, or Tzaddikite fragments, found in the Cairo Geniza, among the stuff that Solomon Schechter, if you haven't seen the exhibit, you have to see it, was able to locate in those texts. And he published in 1911 this text, which is also in our collection, because we also have also new Dead Sea Scrolls fragments. But anyhow, in this document, we find the Dead Sea sectarians say you can only have one wife. Now that debate sort of goes on for a while, and then you can continue to follow that debate into the Mishnaic discussion. And in the Mishnaic discussion, you have something sort of amazing. In the debate between Hillel and Shammai, the house of Shammai is minimalist on debate, on divorce. They say you can only divorce a woman if she commits adultery. The house of Hillel says, even if she burns the food. Now comes the Gemara and says, what are you talking about? If a person divorces the wife of his youth, then even the altar cries, and comes the Rambam and says, it's not the way of the Jewish people, I'll put it sort of simply, for a guy to look for a younger woman and ditch his wife. And so we have this whole thing going on inside Second Temple Judaism. It's the Vorspeise of the debate that is going to happen in the rabbinic text. Now, I would like to get some sense, if I can ask Professor Jassen to tell us, okay, you've seen the book, you've seen the collection, you worked on it, what kind of stuff is in this? What do we mean when we say outside the Bible, the Second Temple period?
This is a great question. I hope everybody's had a chance to go look at the three volumes, as you've heard a few times. This is really, you know, light reading. You'll spend the whole weekend, you know, the students, you'll have winter break to work on it. But in many ways, this is a collection which has to be categorized in some way. And what you find in the ordering of these texts is the way that modern scholars have tried to make sense of this broad collection of texts that have come down to us from antiquity in many different ways that we'll hear about in a moment. And the organization that you find in these texts is, the first is a collection of samples from the Greek translation of the Bible, the Septuagint. We've heard over and over again how the Second Temple period is really to gain insight into the world, the lost world of Judaism. And the Septuagint represents this world of Greek-speaking Jewry, their ways of thinking, their ways of interacting with their sacred texts, their ways of, you can get behind the text to figure out what the social world of Jews, Greek-speaking Jews, what it looked like. That these are not just ancient manuscripts running around in the Second Temple period, these are people who have thoughts and beliefs and questions and dilemmas about how to interpret their scriptural literature, and they're putting this all down on paper. They're taking the time, the resources to put all these thoughts on the paper. So in the Septuagint, for example, we have an attempt to update the sacred scriptures of ancient Israel to make sense of, first of all, the linguistic barrier, where many Jews no longer understood the Hebrew and the Aramaic of the Bible, and they had to translate it into Greek for the Alexandrian community. And in this collection, you have many, many samples of different translations, some of which we would call a very straightforward translation, but as we know, there's no such thing as a very literal translation. Everything is by its very definition an interpretation. And in many cases, we find in our Septuagint samples some very, very interpretive translations. Some of them we would shake our head and say, this is not really a translation, somebody's taking liberties. We also find the works in this collection of two great Jews from the Second Temple period. Whom we know by name, Josephus, the first century CE Jewish historian, without whom we would know none of the historical narrative, or we would know very little of the historical narrative. And he left to us four important writings, of which we have samples in this collection, documenting the history of the Second Temple period. And like all historians, his is not an objective history of what happened, but really a partisan history with an agenda, with interests, and like we all teach our students in our classes, whenever you read modern history, ancient history, you have to figure out what exactly his interest is in. But without him, we would not know the historical background of the Second Temple period. We also have Philo, right? Some of you were just in the Cairo Geniza exhibit and saw the manuscript of Rabban Maimonides' own hand. Maimonides, of course, is most famous for trying to fuse classical philosophy with Jewish tradition. And he has a conversation partner, he just didn't know it. 1,000 years earlier, Philo in Alexandria, a great student of classical philosophy, tries to do the same thing. Philo seems to be less successful. We can debate whether Maimonides was successful, but Philo is less successful because he gets forgotten to all of Jewish tradition. The only reason why we have Philo today is because he was erroneously thought to be a church father by many early Christian scribes, which is why his writings were copied. He has interesting things to say about the Logos, which figures commonly into Christian theology. But Philo attempted to struggle with those same questions.
By the way, a church father who kept Shabbos.
Of course. Well, yes, of course, a very pious church father, yes. But Philo, the thing I love about Philo, I remember this as an undergraduate student, first learning about Philo, where he makes the claim that Moses learns all of his philosophy, sorry, Moses taught all of philosophy to Plato. Right? And this is an audacious claim that we, of course, know is false. And I would suspect that Philo probably knew this as well. But it speaks to this attempt by Jews in the Second Temple period to somehow come to terms with the multiple worlds that are converging around them. Philo, of course, being a citizen of the classical world and a citizen of the Jewish world. And his writings are probably among the most dense of the writings in these texts and will definitely give you, if you're suffering from insomnia, Philo will probably be cured. If you're suffering from existential problems, reality problems, you might also be the cure to that. The other really broad collection in here is something that goes by the misnomer Apocrypha and Pseudepigrapha. And these are problematic terms because no Jew, I guarantee you, in the Second Temple period would have ever called the text Apocrypha, Pseudepigrapha. No Jew in this time period would also refer to things as Bible. But Apocrypha and Pseudepigrapha are terms that exist today and have existed for several hundred years by modern scholars to figure out what to do with all these texts that didn't make it into the Jewish Bible. Right? So the Apocrypha is a term coined during the Reformation by Protestants to describe those texts that were part of the Christian Bible at the time, but had been excluded from the Jewish canon several years earlier. So these are books that were deemed to be not authoritative if you're going by the traditional Jewish canon. This is why we get the incorrect use of the term apocryphal to refer to false, because if they're not part of the true canon, then they are somehow not really correct and they get excluded. But this is, some of you have heard of these books, like the books of 1 and 2 Maccabees that we referred to earlier, without which we would not know the Hanukkah story, The Wisdom of Ben Sira, which is an interesting book that seems to be well known within Jewish tradition throughout the first millennium.
Also found in the Geniza.
Yes.
Manuscripts found in the Cairo Geniza.
And again, a collection of texts, the Pseudepigrapha, which again is a fancy word. Pseudepigrapha technically refers to writings that were falsely attributed to ancient heroes from the biblical past. Nowadays, we advise our students not to plagiarize. That is, not to take somebody else's work and pass it off as your own. In antiquity, there was a form of reverse plagiarism. Nobody cared what any old writer in the second century or first century had to say. They wanted to know that it was ancient, that it was authentic. And what better way to give authority to your work than to say it's written by Moses, or written by Adam, or written by, how about Enoch, right? Enoch, the character who never dies and is somehow in this space between heaven and earth, these are characters that were co-opted and appropriated, their voices co-opted for a text in the Second Temple period to give it instant authority. Right? But the Pseudepigrapha is this collection of texts that is neither sacred for Jews nor sacred for most Christian traditions. Though we have, of course, some strange works surviving only in Ethiopian, which we now have the original Hebrew or Arabic in this collection.
And then, of course, there are the Dead Sea Scrolls.
Yes. I'll save that for you to tell. Yeah, tell me about the Dead Sea Scrolls.
So here's the funny part. The Dead Sea Scrolls partly overlap with some of these other texts. And this is because of the fact that some previously existing so-called apocrypha, like Ben Sira, And so-called pseudepigrapha, like say Enoch and Jubilees, were found in the original language among the Dead Sea Scrolls or Masada manuscripts. So they overlaps. And this, by the way, is one of the reasons why we created what you might call a new canon in this volume, because we figured out a way of classifying the material according to the nature of the material. And someone told me that they were just talking to Professor Feldman. He was explaining that it was the most difficult thing that we did, trying to figure out, you have no idea how many meetings we had about this, and Carol Huffing can tell this story sometime, and she must have had a good time listening to us. Arguing and arguing and arguing, in the end, it came out fantastically. But here's the point. These classifications overlap, because a pseudepigraphon is a book, as we just heard, written in someone's name. But in the scrolls, there are so-called Noah books, which are pseudepigrapha. So the scrolls overlap them. The other thing to understand about the scrolls is that they have their own sectarian type of Bible study, what we call Peshia, and we have in the volume some samples of this. And then we put in here some other Dead Sea Scrolls that are closely linked to the Bible and its interpretation, which is the real theme of Outside the Bible. We didn't try to present the whole Dead Sea Scrolls. Now, one of the things that normally, if you were talking about Dead Sea Scrolls, people start talking about the required Bedouin boy, or who the sectarians are who left us the scrolls. None of that matters from the point of view of what we did in this volume. We're representing ancient biblical interpretation in the scrolls, and certain ancient ideas in the scrolls that we want people to realize were floating around in the post-Hebrew Bible period. And doing that has nothing to do with this one is the author or that one's the author. And one very important point, to have to admit my transgression. In my book, From Text to Tradition, I have a chapter called Apocrypha, Pseudepigrapha, and the Dead Sea Scrolls. And because I repented of that, I pushed from the beginning in this thing, and my colleagues agreed with me, not to do that. Why not to do that is because of this overlapping thing. So the point is that if you read the Dead Sea Scrolls that way, then you're looking at some crazies who went to the shore of the Dead Sea in the middle of the 2nd century BCE or the late 2nd century BCE. And I didn't want to do that. I wanted us to be looking at what types of biblical interpretation and what types of non-biblical texts were existing in the period. And that requires that you get away from classifying the books by where they came from, that is where we got them in the modern era, and you classify them by what they say, because then you can understand the library of ancient Judaism, of Second Temple times. And that's what we try to bring to life in the volume, I think. Yeah. So that was what we were really trying to do.
I'm gonna comment on that, because when I came into this project, I think the title of the work was something else.
Yes, we originally were gonna call this thing, right? But wait, I forget already what it is. We had another name. What was the name we were gonna call it?
I don't remember.
It was called The Lost Bible.
The Lost Bible.
The Lost Bible. And The Lost Bible, first of all, there were about five books with this name. And The Lost Bible, we had objections from some very good scholars who said, look, this is not true. This stuff was never launched. So our problem was we couldn't figure out a title that would sell the book. And so we thought and thought and we argued and argued, and we finally came up with Outside the Bible. And someone asked me recently, at what meeting, I think it might have been Jim Kugel, who was here for the Society of Biblical Literature. His wife didn't want him to stay for Hanukkah with us, and he had to go home. And anyhow, right, I think he was the one who said, when did we really decide it? Do you remember which meeting? Now, Carol Huffing may have the notes, but we spent so much time, and I think in the end, we got a good title until I saw the abbreviation. And the abbreviation is, oh no, OTB, what are we doing over here, right?
So it's too late now.
But it's too late now.
I think that you're right, The Lost Bible is kind of a strange title. When you put The Lost Bible into Amazon, you'll have too much competition. But there is something to be said for calling it The Lost Bible, not because the texts themselves have ever been lost. So some of these have only been found because of discovery in the caves in the Dead Sea. But there is an important point here to be made, is all this terminology we've created about apocrypha, even the term Dead Sea Scrolls, is all from the modern perspective, right? The texts that we call apocrypha are there because these were texts that for one reason or another didn't stay in the Jewish canon, but did make it into the early Christian canon, and are still part of the Catholic canon, and are part of the apocrypha and Protestant tradition. Pseudepigrapha is there because it's not part of the mainstream Jewish or Christian canon, but of course, these are biblical texts. You know, again, the book of Enoch, the first Enoch and the book of Jubilees are biblical texts if you happen to be of the Ethiopian church. But what's more important, though, is if you look at the collection of these texts in the Second Temple period. So if we step out of our modern kind of scholarly fascination with trying to classify antiquity and make sense of where everything belongs in antiquity, when we step back into the world in which these texts were produced, they were not writing a text to say, this is going to become part of the Apocrypha. This is going to be in the Dead Sea Scrolls section of the outside the Bible. They were writing these texts with the intention, right, that this would be scriptural, sacred, authoritative. Whether they had an idea of a Bible yet is beside the point. When somebody wrote the book of Jubilees and they ascribed it to Mosaic authorship, they were claiming that this is equivalent with the Torah, so much so that we actually have references in the Dead Sea Scrolls to the five books of Moses, which may very well refer to the book of Jubilees. And this is true of many, many works within the Second Temple period. These were not meant to be, once upon a time, put into a collection called Outside the Bible. They were meant to be part of the Bible. And for one reason or another, many reasons that we don't actually know specifically, they didn't make the cut.
Right, so here's a funny story. When we were doing the list of articles for the Encyclopedia of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which was edited by myself and Jim Vandekamp, another colleague of ours that is involved in these projects from Notre Dame. And so Eugene Ulrich, who's also from Notre Dame, who's also a very good friend, he said, we can't have an article Bible. Because he didn't think that the Dead Sea Sectarians had a concept of Bible the way we did. He thought they had like an open canon, sort of like what we were just heard from Professor Jason. And I sat there like I was just like amazed. I said, are you kidding? You mean people are going to open up this encyclopedia and there's not going to be an article Bible and everybody wants to know what was the Bible like? So I said, you write an article called Bible and you explain that there's a debate about whether they did or did not understand it the way we do. How could you not have an article Bible? And this sort of illustrates the problem that when we talk about biblical interpretation, we have, among us, among scholars, there are different assumptions about how canonized the Bible was in this period, or when in this period. And obviously, for example, Josephus talks about our biblical canon. He has it, no question. But there's a point at which it takes place. And I've argued that in the MMT document, Mitzat Masei HaTorah, which I had the privilege of doing the commentary for in our new volumes here, I argued that they talk about a tripartite canon, you know, the Torah, the prophets, and the writings. But my good friend Gene Ulrich, he thinks that I'm all wrong, but he thinks I'm wrong because he thinks that a certain piece of a manuscript that has been stuck into a certain place in the restoration doesn't belong there. And you may remember the lawsuit against Herschel Schanks by Alicia Kimrone. Alicia Kimrone put that little piece in. And he claimed that 45% of what he did was guesswork. And this is one of his guessworks. Well, I think he guessed right. But of course, in the lawsuit, he claimed that therefore it was an original act and he won according to Israeli law. But the point I'm making now is that I think Kimrone is right. I think it mentions a three-part Bible. But Gene Ulrich doesn't think so, and this is one of the things in reading the text that we presented here. You have to keep asking yourself, what does it mean that they are interpreting earlier texts, and how do they understand those texts? Do they understand that we understand the Bible? Now, I'd like to just ask Professor Jason here a little bit to go in a little bit into greater depth about what he thinks, because I had a chance before, what he thinks we really learned from this corpus about the Second Temple period. And I think we should spend a little time talking about Christianity, because we don't want to give the impression that there's nothing we learned about Christianity in this material. So anyway, but I'd like to hear what you think is the case with the value of the material.
This is we've heard these texts referred to earlier as some sort of a bridge. If you think about it, think about the traditional canon of Jewish literature. You have the Bible, and the story of the Bible essentially ends in the 5th century BCE. And then you have traditional rabbinic literature, which always picks up in the 2nd century CE. And again, if you take the same question to early Christianity, early Christian literature, depending on how you date the New Testament early text, again, only emerges in the 1st century CE at the earliest, and then primarily into the 1st and 2nd century, where most of these texts come to fruition. So we're talking about, within the literary production of Judaism, at least 4 or 5 centuries where, as you can imagine, Jews were not doing anything. This was an incredibly vibrant world of creativity, where Jews were trying to make sense of their sacred scriptures, were trying to make sense of how to live their life as Jews, where they see themselves as the heirs to the Israelite tradition. Just to give an example that is near and dear to both of our work, the history of halakha, right? And I always ask my students this question, is what exactly does one do on Shabbat according to the Bible, right? And this is something, maybe take a minute and think about it. Think to yourself, if you read the Bible, right, I'll let you take all the 24 books of the Bible. What exactly can you not do on Shabbat, right? And I guarantee you, your list won't be very long. Both things you do and things you don't, right? We hear about not doing any melacha, not doing any work. But the question, of course, becomes what is work, right? We hear about some specifics like don't cook, don't kindle a fire. But how about this reference in the book of Exodus to nobody leaving their place, right? So what does that mean? What does it mean not to leave your place? What we find when we read through the Second Temple period literature is, again, we've heard this question about a vigorous debate. A debate about whether this means, can you not leave your home? Can you not take anything with you out of your home? Can you go a certain distance out of your home, right? The same question presents itself when, in the book of Isaiah. Isaiah condemns those on Shabbat who are doing their business dealings and speaking a word. And he basically says, you're not allowed to speak anything. And here we find a very simple reading of this text suggests that one cannot speak anything on Shabbat.
But actually, one of the scrolls texts, which I just worked on recently, actually says you can only speak, you're going to get a laugh out of this, about matters of holiness or food.
this is part of the vigorous debate that's going on about how to make sense of one's sacred text, because Jews, like today, who like to debate and like to argue about what texts mean, in antiquity, were forced to debate in the sense that they had these sacred writings, but the biblical heritage was a double-edged sword. Because on the one hand, it provided a template for how to live their lives, right? You have these institutions and these ideas. You have the idea that there is a Davidic king who will rule forever. But what do you do with the fact that there is no more Davidic king around? And this develops this idea in the Second Temple period that there is a Davidic dynasty that will rule forever. It just has disappeared for a little bit. And this is where we start to see in the 2nd century BC the beginnings of messianic speculation and end-time speculation and the notion that there will be a Davidic king that will come in the future to rescue these Jews who are suffering under first Greek oppression and then Roman oppression. And all of these thought patterns, all this creative speculation, and all this literary activity is something that Jews were doing because their sacred scriptures had to be constantly reinterpreted. They never stood as just literary artifacts. They were constantly under interpretation. And they provide the window, the social background, to the same type of activity going on in Rabbinic Judaism, the same type of activity going on among early Christians, about how to make sense of their sacred traditions.
And just to pick up the example we had, notice this interesting fact that you have the story of, well, I shouldn't say story, the problem of someone whose animal falls into a pit. The same exact issue is in the Dead Sea Scrolls, where you have the strictest view, let the animal die, basically, don't violate Shabbat or you don't compromise. And then you move over to the rabbis where they want you to put something into the pit, and hit the animal on the back or something, get him to jump out, but don't directly take him out if it's forbidden on Shabbat. And then you move to the debate in the New Testament where the early Christians, apparently, putting it in the mouth of Jesus, seemed to have the idea that, you know, who wouldn't take his animal out of the pit if the water was rising? And so you see that the same debates are running across these groups. And that's why in the earliest stages of Christianity, the material in our work here helps us to understand the environment in which Christianity grows up. But some of you who may remember the title of my book, Reclaiming the Dead Sea Scrolls, and the fierce polemic that took place when the scrolls were first becoming popular and when the demands were going on for the full publication, will remember that I was arguing there that the Christian side was being terribly exaggerated. And to some extent, these volumes here are a continued attempt to redress that, because we have a commentary which emphasizes the rabbinic literature side of what's relevant in these things and the Jewish side of what's relevant, while not ignoring true relevance to Christianity. I have to tell you something funny, because Dr. Hittery is here. So he was one of those who went over people's work to make sure they didn't miss rabbinic references. And he even caught me in my Maccabees commentary and added some material that I didn't have. And the bottom line is that we tried our hardest to make sure that that tie to Judaism as we know it is there precisely because of the issues that we've been talking about. But at the same time, when you actually take a look at the side of Christianity, it's much more the environment. It shows you the kind of environment in which Christianity, we just mentioned this whole business about messianism, when it turns into apocalyptic, immediate messianism, which you have a lot of in the Dead Sea Scrolls, you start to understand how Christians could early on have believed that a certain figure was the Messiah. And while we obviously have theological debates with the Christian ideas, there's no question that many of these ideas do stem from Jewish ideas that we can now fully document in the various Second Temple texts, and which when you read them, I think you'll understand it a little bit better than you would have.
Yeah, this is. I mean, the Christian project is really important. And I remember at some point in the early conversation, I don't remember who it was, suggesting that the Christian evidence should only be brought into the commentary where it's directly relevant. And I thought to myself, well, it's always directly relevant because the claim we make for this, for the Dead Sea Scrolls and all these ancient texts being relevant for rabbinic Judaism is the same claim we make for early Christianity, that these provide the background. And I actually happen to be, I teach in a course right now at NYU on the Dead Sea Scrolls, and we did our lesson on the Dead Sea Scrolls and the background of Christianity. And you probably would have enjoyed this because I was channeling my old teacher here, referring to many, many people as crazy and crazier than crazy. Because what you actually find among many early scholars of the Dead Sea Scrolls is that there are those who wanted to make the claim that the Dead Sea Scrolls and their discovery undermined everything new about Christianity. And this was done among people who had a polemical kind of agenda. In many ways, they were correct in the sense that they were making the claim that what is oftentimes seen as unique and novel about the early Christian theology and early Christian identity already had its precursors in Jewish tradition. Now, this is all correct, but what happens is, of course, people are on national news and newspapers basically saying that this undermines all of Christianity. But at the core of the argument, this is very much true, that what you find among early Christian theology is another attempt to make sense of the sacred tradition of Judaism, another attempt to understand things like the suffering servant of Isaiah in a new theological context. And this is one slice of the world of Second Temple Judaism that survives, the other slice, of course, being rabbinic Judaism as the heir to the Pharisaic tradition, and we might say another sliver of the pie within the Samaritans. But everybody else, all the other worlds of Second Temple Judaism have disappeared, and we're reclaiming them in some sense through a work like this.
Right, so this is something that is really interesting, this whole question of how this material somehow or another mostly disappeared and how some of it survived. Now the funny part about it is it's easier to talk about the survival. Some texts, as we already heard to some extent about Philo and Josephus and about the Apocrypha, were preserved in various Christian churches. And of course the so-called pseudepigrapha was preserved in Eastern churches, some of it in Slavonic and some of it in Ethiopic. And all this was rediscovered basically starting in the 1700s, but some of it rediscovered already in the Renaissance. But then in the 1700s by European explorers, this kind of thing. But then, of course, at the same time, some of it was rediscovered in the Cairo Geniza and other stuff in the Qumran scrolls. And so we have a whole story of rediscovery. But the funny part is we can't explain how some of it survived. So, for example, we have this so-called Damascus document of Zadokite fragments found in the Cairo Geniza. It's the first Dead Sea Scroll that was ever published in 1911, before Qumran was ever looked at. And here you have a document which basically survived in the Middle Ages in some underground way. And there were two theories. One is it stayed with the Karaites, who picked up some of these sectarian ideas, the literalist Jewish sect. Another idea is that there were some discoveries of scrolls in ancient and medieval times at the area of the shore of the Dead Sea or near the Jordan River. I have a problem with this because these accounts usually speak about Psalms or other biblical books, but nonetheless, maybe something, we don't really have the answer to this. And so in a certain way, the story of what we're doing with these texts is we are reintegrating texts into the history of the Jewish people that have often just been ignored. And so by having the Jewish content, now one of the things about this problem about in our volume, about how much of the Christian stuff to include, actually the balance came out because of the authors. When we started, we thought that maybe all the material should be written, all the commentary and introductions, by by people who really had an understanding of later Judaism. We soon discovered that this was impossible and crazy, because we had so many colleagues whose training was initially in Christianity, but who worked in these documents, that worked with us and go to conferences with us and participate in many of our events, including, by the way, the Yeshiva University seminar for the study of the Dead Sea Scrolls. And these people have so much to contribute. So we hit on the idea of having a wider variety of people write the articles, and then having these rabbinic editors, which were Professors Hittery and Elman. And what then happened was that we ended up getting the integration of the Christian material into many of these texts in a way which is appropriate and right. Because these are not people, we spoke about the crazies and the movie. None of these are part of these crazies who we can say it disproves Christianity, it proves Christianity. They're really great scholars who know a tremendous amount about Judaism. I mean, I talked before about Jim Vandekamp. I watched him read an article in Haaretz in which John Strugnell made his anti-Semitic remarks when they were talking about the publication of the Dead Sea Scrolls in 1990. I watched him scan down a page in Haaretz. Most of the Jews can't read Haaretz. And he's the only person I know that read cover to cover my book, Halakha, Halakha, Mashichiyut, Mekatan, Bar Yudah, which, as you can tell, is in Hebrew. So these guys contributed so much to our project because of this knowledge they have, and yet it caused us to end up with a more balanced thing than we might have thought at the beginning, which I think is a really important factor. So, I mean, that's a great thing. Now, the one thing which I think is also interesting is the fact that I think only Ben Sira, you mentioned this before, and I don't really know why this is, Ben Sira is the one text that's quoted in the Gemara as if it's Bible when it's not Bible. And of course, anyone who's read it knows that it's totally a kosher kind of book. Now, this is really a great story about survival, because they had it in Greek. You find remnants of it in the Cairo Geniza in medieval manuscripts. And then there were little slivers at Qumran, but Yadid found in Masada for the whole back part of the text, half the book practically, in a Hebrew manuscript, a whole scroll. And so this is just another example of how much of what we have in here is the taking back of our heritage, which is our heritage and our history, that somehow or another was being lost.
Yeah, this is. I also want to just second this notion of the ecumenical nature of the, we might say, interfaith, whatever kind of word you want to use. This is something we as scholars take for granted nowadays, but there was once upon a time where modern scholarship on Dead Sea Scrolls, on the Second Temple literature, was very much divided among confessional lines. And Jews and Christians, as in their scholarship, very rarely interacted. It's well known that Jews were, of course, excluded from the early editorial team of the Dead Sea Scrolls. In many ways, this is not just an attempt to reclaim these texts for Jewish tradition, but this is very much an attempt to reclaim these texts as part of the shared heritage of Judaism and Christianity. We've mentioned this over and over again, that these texts, for both Judaism and Christianity, these texts are part of the breeding ground, part of the fertile world that produces traditional rabbinic Judaism as well as Christianity. And this is, again, an interfaith editorial board, interfaith list of contributors.
Yeah. So here's a really interesting thing. Our colleague, Eileen Schuler, who is herself a Roman Catholic nun, although you wouldn't know it because they don't wear the clothes anymore, but she wrote an article in which she argues that the founding of the Dead Sea Scrolls was one of the stimuli for the changes in the Catholic Church regarding its attitudes to Judaism. And actually, she quotes me in the article as having told her that the great scholar William Foxwell Albright, the great scholar of the biblical and ancient Near Eastern materials, that he actually said to Samuel Ivry, who was a Jewish student of his at the time, that had the scrolls been discovered 10 years earlier, there would not have been a Holocaust. Now, she also quotes me saying that this is obviously not true. It's obviously false. But the point is that Albright was so taken by the ability to trace the beginnings of Christianity in Judaism that he thought if Christians truly understood that their religion comes from the Jewish religion, that the Holocaust could not have happened. I think, again, that's not true and it's exaggerated. But it's a very interesting indication of the way in which the literature that we're talking about is part of the understanding that Christianity has its roots in Judaism, which is a key part of the lowering of the anti-Semitic views among Christian groups post-Holocaust, which of course is the real cause of these changes in Christianity today. So that's an interesting reality. So let's, I think, ask another question as we start to come to an end. What does this stuff have to do with Hanukkah? So like, what stuff is in here about Hanukkah? So I just want to mention, you know, we heard a beautiful quotation from the books of the Maccabees. And most Jews don't realize how the books of the Maccabees, which only began to be at least read as is during the Renaissance by Jews. There were earlier collections and materials here or there and effects in different ways. But one of the things that's interesting is that today certain things in Maccabees are typically told in the Hanukkah story. And one of them that I'm just going to mention is the idea that there was a struggle over how much to Hellenize. You only get that from two Maccabees, which isn't used by Josephus. And until Jews read two Maccabees, then who knew anything about this? Now, I'll tell you something very funny. There's a Jew in the Renaissance who was most key to this, and that is Azariah the Rossi. But he is considered a heretic, so you can't buy his book, Mori 9, but you can buy it in English, translated and published by a modern scholar and available from Yale. And you see there that all the modern scholarly, historical issues and all this already being raised by him based on his reading. But it's also interesting to note, and this we can't go through in detail, and I actually spoke about this for an hour just yesterday to some YU alumni in Midtown, that actually you can trace the whole dynasty of the Hasmoneans in the Dead Sea Scrolls, because we have places where the scrolls help us to illuminate things that we knew about before from Josephus. And there are a few really great examples where we now understand certain things because the scrolls have these sort of hidden allusions to events we otherwise knew in tracing the Hasmonean dynasty. But you know, the Dead Sea Scrolls people didn't like the Maccabees and probably didn't celebrate Hanukkah. So we've got in our collection here the pro-Maccabean books, the first and second Maccabees, and we got some Dead Sea Scroll material that seems to be alluding negatively, indirectly, to the Maccabean dynasty, as we call them, of the Hasmoneans.
These people are rolling over in their graves. The Qumran sectarians, their writings, their cherished writings, where they talk about the Maccabees and the wicked priest, are in the same collection of the books of Maccabees.
Yeah, there may be a lot of people turning over in their graves, but I hope that won't happen to us.
Yeah. I think that maybe I could just speak to one thing about, we're sitting here on Hanukkah, and again, we've all been told these stories as children about the Hanukkah story, and I think if we were told the story exclusively as known from traditional rabbinic sources, the story would be told very quickly.
We wouldn't know Judah the Maccabee,
of course.
His name would appear. Yeah, we'd be in trouble.
The brothers would know all these great stories, and I mean, the stories are remarkable stories, but it goes to the very core of these questions. You know, why do we celebrate Hanukkah for 8 nights? Right. Of course, we're told the story that they discovered the Pach Shem and the cruz of oil, and it lasts for you know, it was only enough to last for one night, but it lasts for 8 nights. But why not celebrate it for 7 nights? Right. And the interesting thing is, in this, there is an allusion to this to the answer. In,
we wouldn't be able to use Hanukkahs. They have 8 kids.
Right. Right. Of course. Well, yes. Presumably, they wouldn't be made like that. But my son's menorah that he made actually broke off, so maybe we could use the 7 branches that were left. He made
it. This is not funny. There's a scholar who claimed that there were tefillin in Qumran that only have 3 sections. Why? It was broken, and he couldn't see the photograph. It was broken, so he said they have 3 sections in tefillin. I mean,
but so in the Talmudic passage, right, in the Shabbat where it talks about Hanukkah, there's this debate between Beit Shammai and Beit Hillel about whether to go from 1 candle to 8 candles or 8 candles to 1 candle. So what's the explanation for Beit Shammai why you go from 8 to 1?
Well, because it gets whether you go by the days that are coming or the days that we then
but there's an allusion. Right. There's an allusion to how the sacrifice.
Yes, namely to Sukkot.
So when you read this passage, you read this passage in the Talmud, and you say, Beit Shammai says the reason why you go from 8 to 1 is because that's how the sacrifice and the Sukkot were provided. So you're left kind of scratching your head, wondering what in the world is the Sukkot. And the answer is only provided. Perhaps we can hear what page in the outside the Bible volume 2 Maccabees is in. We learn in 2 Maccabees. That when the first Hasmoneans come and rededicate the temple, and they do the first Hanukkah is celebrated as a substitute Sukkot, because this is, of course, when the previous holiday that they missed, because as we're told in 2 Maccabees, they were out in the hills fighting the battle, so they couldn't properly celebrate Sukkot. They couldn't properly celebrate anyways because the temple was defiled. And in the description of the first Hanukkah celebration,
into Maccabees. What are they doing?
Blue
not playing dreidel.
Yeah, they have blue lemon etro.
It's
like my famous question, why we don't have the Seder or the Sukkah, right? Or why won't, well, either that or why don't we have the Sukkah during Pesach? It's the same thing, right?
Right. Right, exactly.
They were doing it.
So I mean, imagine if the Hanukkah today, this of course doesn't survive because it would be a little bit confusing why you have the Lubavitch and Sukkot, and then you know, a month and a half later you have it again.
But it's interesting, if you look in traditional sources until today, they're constantly making analogies between Hanukkah and Sukkot. Right. And this is a continued heritage of something in Second Temple literature that you don't know why it is. And there's so many examples of this that you see when you study, somebody really reads the commentary of our stuff, they're gonna see those allusions. And this is a really great example that you're citing. So I think we're probably about running out of our time over here, am I right? Our boss is telling us.
Right on time, perfect.
Yeah. So are we taking questions? Or
yeah,
are we,
just a couple minutes of questions, sure. And then a closing remark.
Okay, fantastic. So what, 5 minutes questions?
Sure.
Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, yeah, we have time for some questions.
Microphone for the audience.
We'll repeat the question. Go ahead.
All right. I did some traveling in North Africa, particularly Libya. And the guides kept saying these ruins happened during the Jewish War. Yep. And I think that they were referring to about the second century CE. What Jewish war?
Okay, so believe it or not, between the Great Revolt of the Jews against Rome, which took place, as everybody knows, from 66 to 73 CE, Masada destroyed in 73, Jerusalem in 70, the temple, and the Bar Kokhba War of 132 to 135, there was a Jewish diaspora revolt. And what we know from this is that there are numerous sources, especially inscriptions, found all over, which refer to the large number of people killed by the Jews and to places that were rebuilt because they were destroyed in the Jewish revolt. And the numbers of people killed is very large, and this, in a bizarre way, came between the two revolts, and it also may be, for those people who are the Daf Yomi types, may be represented in the stories of Pappus and Lulianus, which are found in the Talmud, and they led some type of group of revolutionaries who seemed to have come from Egypt to Eretz Israel, and then there were these guys who put out these like Kool-Aid stands where the people coming could get drinks on the way to what may have been an abortive attempt to have an in-between revolt between the first revolt and the second revolt in Eretz Israel. So what these people were telling you is true. And in fact, this led to the death of the Jewish community of Cyprus, even though I see that there are now two Chabads in northern and southern Cyprus. One of them is a full shul with minyan three times a day. But there has not been a serious Jewish community in Cyprus since it was destroyed in this period of basically 115 to 117, because the natives basically fought back against the Jews and drove them out and killed them. And this is a very sorry episode.
Which, of course, we only know all this because of Josephus.
That's right, and the inscriptions also, which is enough. We wouldn't know anything about any of these events.
I just wondered where Christianity went bad when it went from this kind of Reformed Judaism that you to this kind of...
You mean where it abandoned the halakha?
Right.
No, this is a good question. I wouldn't characterize it where Christianity went bad. The question is, when do we stop thinking about Christianity as a form of Judaism? I think the question is, really, I mean, it's more appropriate to talk about the early followers of Jesus. And Christianity is really something different. And this is something that historians really debate. There are historians who have suggested that this idea of a parting of the ways doesn't happen until the 3rd or 4th century, or perhaps even later. That there are Jews and Christians mingling in synagogues. There are people who are on some sort of middle space between Jewish and Christian identity. But I would suggest that probably towards, you know, as we get into the 3rd and 4th century, as Christianity begins to be more for more with what we would call so-called pagan religious traditions, it loses a lot of its Jewish character. And some of this is already taking place with Paul's revisions and Paul's debates with the other forms of Jesus followers that were around. But again, what we're seeing here, even within that kind of Christianity as it develops over the full first millennium, the background is still very much the Jewish context. There was another hand right here.
Is there any use
in practice in the temple of any of these texts. The text in your three volumes.
What was that word? Is there any what?
Use.
Use, okay.
Do they read it in the temple? Do they go off to a different room?
Well, see,
in the temple?
No, see, here's what happens.
Yeah.
We have a whole lot of different texts that we're talking about. So let's remember that most Jews, and this, by the way, even includes the first Christians, worship in the temple regularly, which means probably going for one holiday a year or something like this. Josephus, by the way, says that there were 290,000 Korban Pesach, Paschal sacrifices, with 10 people on each one. So that would be about 2.9 million people coming to a specific holiday. And you can think it's exaggerated, but let's put it this way. A heck of a lot of people came. There's not small numbers. Now, the thing is that most Jews participated in temple worship in this way, not every holiday. The Dead Sea sectarians and the Essenes, whether they are the same or not, described by Philo and Josephus, they had different approaches. The Essenes, as described by Josephus, had their own room in the temple where they ate their sacrifices because of their stricter purity laws. The Dead Sea sectarians said it's forbidden to go there because we don't approve of it. But nonetheless, they had enormous amounts of temple material about the rituals, because they believed you're supposed to go there if it only would be run the right way. And they thought that after the big war of the sons of light against the sons of darkness, they would go back and take over the temple. So they have this thing called the temple scroll, which the truth of the matter is something I've been studying for like, I don't know, 40 years already. The temple scroll is a volume which spells out in great detail how you run the temple, but it's a reformist document, how you should run the temple, not the way it was being run. So there's enormous amount. And then the MMT text, which tells why the sectarians left, they protest 22 things about the sacrifices and ritual purity that they think are not being done right by the people who are running the show in Yerushalayim.
But I'm glad you said that, because I didn't know. I'm thrilled with your answer. My original question was, you have all of these texts, you have this corpus, you have what we call our Bible now, and we have what you have in your publication now. Do any of these texts get utilized for temple ritual? Or for study?
They're used for the ritual.
Could you repeat the question?
Yeah, if I understand the question, she's asking whether or not these texts that we publish here were actually used in the worship of the Jerusalem temple, or if I can sort of add to the thing, where the only text that was used in the worship was what you would expect, the Torah, which we know was being read by the end of this period in the temple. But I think we
should rephrase the question. As far as I can tell, first of all, we don't know. The answer is it possible? As you've taught me many years ago, when the question starts out, is it possible? The answer is always maybe.
Right.
It's possible that some of these texts would have been.
Actually, you left out part of my quote. If this person who asks the question is sitting in something like this and they know some information and they ask you, then it's gotta be maybe.
But I think the interesting question, though, is what you do have. I don't know how many of these texts do show up in this collection, but you do have, for the first time, primarily in the Dead Sea Scrolls, is the beginning of alternative methods of worship. As the temple is kind of on its way out in the history of Judaism, you start to see beginning, already with the temple still standing, the emergence of liturgical traditions where instead of worshiping God through animal sacrifice, you're worshiping God through words. And there's allusions to this in the Dead Sea Scrolls where they refer to, remember, the Dead Sea Scrolls community is in a self-imposed exile from the temple. So they have to find a way to negotiate the same goals in which temple sacrifice would have been done, right? So if temple sacrifice cleanses Israel and individuals of their sins and their wrongdoing, if temple sacrifice keeps the world in its order, then you need to find an effective method to substitute instead of temple sacrifice. And the Qumran sectarians seem to have done that through, particularly through the emergence of what we call prayer. And they actually refer to their prayer as offerings of the lips. And the term for offerings is the word that we would refer to, Timramat Sifatayim, like the sacrifices of one's lips. And we start to see the Dead Sea Scrolls, not what we would call, as one early scrolls called the Proto-Siddur, which was never discovered, but the beginnings of institutionalized prayer. Specific words that are meant to be said at specific times. And this is, again, something we haven't discussed.
And the reading of the Shema, by the way, this is the earliest text which indicates, right, I think it's true, and my YU colleague, Moshe Bernstein, who also works on scrolls, agrees that this is the earliest, in one of the Dead Sea Scrolls, the earliest mention of the reading of the Shema as a ritual to be done twice a day by Jews.
That's right. You have references to the Birkat HaMazon, and these also kind of augment references in Josephus, where he describes the Essenes as engaging in prayer. And so these are, again, important touchstones in the history of Jewish tradition, where they open up that transition point between the world of ancient Israel and the Bible, where everything was temple-centered, everything was animal sacrifice-centered, and the world of rabbinic Judaism and early Christianity, where we see the shift to worship through words.
So I want to say one thing sort of out of turn before we hear the important words of Professor Feldman. And that is that when you sit here and listen to this, you understand why, when people said to me, don't you think if you leave NYU, the department will suffer? I was convinced when I found out who was replacing me, the department's not suffering.
You know? Yeah.
Thank you. It's embarrassing. Thank you. Thank you to Professor Schiffman and Professor Jassen for including us in this conversation. Being able to listen in on the conversation of scholars is indeed a privilege, and one that is opening up this important gap of several centuries long. It's very humbling to be in the presence of an individual who is arguably the world's greatest authority on Josephus and on Philo. He knew them personally. and we're so delighted that Professor Feldman was able to join us this evening.
I want to express my appreciation to the Jewish Publication Society and the University of Nebraska for undertaking this project. I also want to thank my co-editors, Larry Schiffman and James Kugel, for all their hard work, and especially their consultation on tough questions such as who should undertake various specific topics. I truly want to thank Yeshiva University for encouraging us and coordinating this meeting. Having been a teacher at Yeshiva for over 50 years, I think it's especially fitting that this evening is being sponsored by my university and is devoted to bridging this work to the attention of the greater public. There were two major problems that we had to grapple with when editing this work. What should be included, and how much space should be given to each topic? I hope that when you look at our first text, you will see that we perhaps made a good right choice in terms of the topics and in terms of the scholars who wrote about them. We are proud that we produced a work that we hope will be available to a large audience. Many of the individual topics have never been put in print, and they will now be in correlation with one another. I thank you so much for coming, and welcome your comments and corrections.
Professor Feldman, is there anything you wanted to add about the veracity and accuracy of your colleagues who spoke this evening?
Scholarship begins with ignorance. And very often ends with it. Having said that at all.
Thank you all. And happy Hanukkah. Please visit the JPS booth. Thank you.